Hello and welcome to BusyWorksBeats.com. Today I'm going to review a song I was creating recently, and I want to kind of let you into the project to show you a couple techniques I used to make this song more interesting. So I'll give you things that you just generally wouldn't think about or a general technique. I'm going to preview the song first, then we're going to go back and kind of point out different areas of influence in the song. So you can see how many tracks we have, a lot of automation. Well, not a lot, but you can see we have a lot of tracks here. Okay, so now that we heard the track, I'm going to point out a couple things that are unorthodox that took this track to another level, for me at least. And I know a lot of people are going to ask about the mixing chains, but the song isn't fully mixed yet. So that's why I'm saying it's not mixed. It's because I can't explain the mixing chains yet because it's not fully done. Not that I'm saying that the song is the quality it is because it's not mixed. So first, what I started out with was actually a piano part. I'm not sure why that noise is occurring. It's a little weird. but let's solo this. Why is that noise? Track 35. What is going on? Oh, guitar rig. Okay. Turn that off. Okay. So anyway, I started with this piano. Now it was longer than what it looks right now. And that's the key. You know, when you're doing audio recordings, you could chop it up and almost treat it like a sample. So this piano is really much longer. What I did was I narrowed it down to this specific area because it was getting too heavy in the beginning. But let me just show you what I started out with. Now this is an A minor going into a G augmented chord or G major with the top note going up to the next note in the scale. So 048 would be the chord code of the augmented. And again, you can learn more about chord codes at BusyWorksBeats.com/music-theory. So I went A minor, then we dropped down to G augmented, and then every alternative I would do an F major 7 chord. So those are the chords. So here's how I started, just with chords. And the chords generated all the ideas for everything else. even though I cut out the chords, throughout the song, this generated ideas for everything else. This is why I say most stuff starts with the chords. So that's the gist of the piano chord progression. And it stimulated a mood, you know, an identity for the song. The second element I added in, I didn't get to rhythms until, you know, after the musicality. I think the rhythm might have come next, actually, in this song. So I get the question a lot. Okay, Game, what's your style? This would be a song that really hones into my true style. It's because I didn't really have a vision for this. So how I grew the song was to be creatively thinking of ways to expand and force my thought process to push the song forward. And at every level of the song, I said, how can I push it even further? But I didn't have a solid vision behind it. So this is more of a lab experiment. And this is where you can really see my raw ideas without the revisions and curations and all that type of stuff. So the rhythm came second, and that's all the percussion. I'm not going to be boring and tell you, oh, here's a kick, here's a snare. I'm pretty sure you know what a snare and a kick are. But let me solo the rhythm so you can hear what how exotic the drums are. They're not just like boom, clap, boom, boom, clap. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing. But if you listen to the drums, there's a lot going on. It feels like pop drums almost. There's a lot of expression. Stop here, because that shaker that you hear in the background, I used that early on before I decided to bring this kind of desert feel to the song. And that was essential, because if you're familiar with that rattle noise, that rattle percussion, that I didn't use the rattle, I used more of a shaker. But if you're familiar with that rattle noise, we associate that noise with the desert or desert style of music. And that, I guess, put a subconscious mark in my mind to say, okay, we need some desert style guitar. So small pieces always push the envelope to the next level. So a lot of people ask me, how do you spice up your drums? Add mutes, take stuff out. And that was one point that I added a mute to emphasize the vocal. And we're gonna get to the vocal in a second, but that's the gist of the rhythm, but I'll play it out to the next two bars. So you can hear the drums aren't just like boom, clap, 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 boom, clap. You know, it's a lot of movement, a lot of different drum choices. So it's not just the same kick drum. Sometimes I switched out the kick drum or added a percussion element to make it feel like a kick drum. So these are all small decisions that I made along the way. So let me control Z my way back to where it was before. And so after all that rhythm talk, here's where the guitar came in. And once I started adding the guitar, I realized that the piano was just too much. It was too much going on. So I took out the piano, and you see I left the guitar. So the guitar was running on the same philosophy as the piano, the same chord philosophy. So let's just play the beginning with the... I'm going to turn off the sound effects and turn off the harmonization. So here's where I started. Let me turn this off. So in the beginning, the chord you hear from the guitar, that was really just me just testing to make sure I was on the right chord. But it actually came out as a good intro stamp to give us that deserty type of vibe. Now the guitar chords are a little bit different, because I think I went A minor, and then I did, let me see, not A augmented, but I dropped the root note of A. No, I dropped the root note of B diminished. Instead of playing B, I played A instead. So technically, it's an inverted D minor chord with A inverted down to the root note. So that's how I came up with the guitar chords. I played a little bit. Instead of going downward with the chords, I went upward. So it creates a contrast with the piano. And that's why the piano isn't here, layered with the guitars, because they're going in two different directions. So I had to take it out. And notice they're playing also a percussive type of way. They're not just playing long chords. So the guitar, you know, was a key essential piece into the vibe. And this took the vibe from like a pop, you know, soul song into more of a deserty type of pop sound rather than, you know, that kind of aggressive piano tone. Now, I'm not even sure what this is. I think these are guitar. This is another guitar take where I just added, you know, an octave of the note A. So just A octaves, down, lower, higher, and then lower. Okay, so, and then that spawned the vocal idea. Now I'm not gonna make it boring and say, this is what came next. I'm just gonna get straight to the why I did stuff. So here's the original hook. And the reason I'm pointing this out is because the way I was thinking was, how can I push it further than this? So here's the original hook. So that was the original hook, but once I realized I started adding harmonies, there's a musical flaw between the part, so I cut that out because musically it wasn't matching with the next harmony. So I said, how can I push this even further? And your brain starts giving you harmonization ideas, and here's one of them. So we went from that kind of deserty, kind of Aztec, you know, Native American type of influence, and then we brought in this kind of high-pitched harmony section, more of a modern pop choice. And then I said, how can I take this to another level? And I said, let's add another harmony, but at the end. So I take it up even higher in octave, in the pitch at the end. And you can see how many takes I did. I did 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I don't know why I did 7. That's an odd number. but I forget why. The process of this. Because, you know, these are all different takes. These aren't clones. These are just takes in the moment. And I just wanted to capture the energy at the time. And that's what it turned out to be. Now it's a 7 of them. Pan, left, right, center. To give that full sound. A lot of people are like, which plugin do you use to get that full chorus sound? It's not a plugin, it's just multiple takes panned in different areas. And when you have slight pitch variation in your vocal takes, even though I ran these through auto-tune mostly, as you know, you can hear in the pitch perfection, but that's because I'm not a pure singer. What was I gonna say? Oh, pitch variation between the vocal takes creates that chorusing effect, because what chorusing really is multiple takes or multiple voices, just like multiple people in a room, and they're singing the same notes, but they're slightly off in pitch, and they're panned, they're placed in a different position, whether that's left, right, or center. And that's what creates the chorus effect, and that's what creates that blur, pitch blur, as we call it. So it's the same thing with your voice. If you record multiple takes, pan them, and then make them each slightly different in pitch, you're going to get a chorusing effect without any plugins. So that's what chorus actually is. Now the next section is a little more complex. I'm not going to break down every element, but the cool elements that I want to break down, well, of course you heard the bass line, it is what it is. But some things you might not notice is my breathing here. It comes in a little more evident towards the end, but okay, so I'm doing that breathing to add texture to the sound, so it's not just clean. I wanted it to feel like it's a real thing, like we're around a fire, you know, just jamming out in the desert. So here's another vocal take. Now again, I had more vocal takes, but I chopped out the parts that I didn't want. And this is what you're going to do when you have a lot of audio. This is what we call arrangement, where you slice out stuff and you rearrange it. You literally move it around, and that's where the term came from, because you're dealing with, you know, solid ideas rather than MIDI. But anyway, here's, I'm saying don't And again, when I finish the mixing chain, I'll show you the mixing chain, but it's not complete. So you can hear, you can even hear the phasing of the take. I left all those in there to make it more, to feel like it's something. You know, everybody wants their song to be super clean. In this case, I wanted it to feel real. So I'm adding those noises, those flaws, as people say. Now here's another track I added, which is not evident. And I'm just saying, don't, you know, I'm getting ready for the vocal that's saying don't. So I'm like, don't, you know, that kind of stuff. Now it looks like I might have muted this one. Now on this one, I've added the effects of delay. So I'm going to turn that off. Now I'm not sure if that's actually going to turn it off or not. So let me see. So that's the sound we're getting. That bouncing around. And I wanted that. It was an accident, actually, towards the end of the song, just like what happened before. The delay was on, but I didn't want it on. And I'm like, wow, this is actually a cool sound. Let me actually experiment with that in the first half. Because on the second half, you can see I was more meticulous about the automation. And I did this really cool technique with the triangle. So instead of just having delay come in immediately, I had it swell into a delay. And it goes, it goes, and it kind of builds up into this delay, and it becomes a new element of the song. And I thought that was really cool over here. But then what I realized is I can create this really trippy vibe if I just turn the delay on high feedback and just crank it all the way up. So it's, the feedback is all the way up. So you can hear it here. Just constantly, and it creates a new element. So this is why I say sometimes you have to record into the effects. Even though I didn't record into that effect, this is something that I just couldn't imagine without the effect being on. So let's go back, and I think that's all there is to show you on that section. Now the next thing I realized is that the song had a desert kind of vibe because of that guitar. So I said, how can I make this more desert-like? And I'm thinking of ways. I'm like, So what I did was I've added sound effects of a desert, you know, with crickets and then a wolf howl to kind of make this more deserty. I know that doesn't make sense, but these are the effects I'm using. And then it cuts out. So those subtleties build in the brain associations with the environment that we're in. So when we start hearing crickets and wolves howling, we assume we're in the desert somewhere, because where do you hear wolves howling along with crickets? So it just kind of has that vibe. Now, I could have took this to another level if I added a crackling fire to make it feel like we're actually around a fire. So I may do that next, add a crackling fire in the background so it feels like we're around a campfire. And I like to introduce these real environments into my songs because I want you to feel the song. I don't want you to just hear it. I want you to feel it and feel like you're in that space. So we create realism by blending real elements with synth elements. So some of these are real instruments. Some of these are synth instruments. The only synthesized things really are the drums, or not synthesized, but you know, more cleaned up things, and the bass line. Now here's my most exciting part to me in this song, because of the bass line just revs it up to a completely new level, along with all the vocal effects. And I think that covers the song. Now one more patch, I have a couple vocal things here, which I just ran through Guitar Rig. I'm trying to see where else it got exotic. I think that's about it. So I can cut the video short. I don't want to make it too long. But you can see I'm chopping up the piano, putting different chords in different places. It's not just one long chord progression all the way through. Sometimes you'll start with a chord progression and you move it around and you slice it up and it turns into something else. So that's why I say chords generate the song. The chords literally were the foundation for this whole song. If I didn't have those chords down, who knows where the song would have, you know, would have gone, or where it would have gone, and who knows, you know, if it would have even been if I didn't have that chord technology. You can learn about chords, more about chords, at busyworksbeats.com. /chordmagic. And there we have many videos on different genres of chords and techniques you can use, from jazz to house to neo soul. And I use those techniques frequently in a lot of these songs to give them different moods and vibes. So let me play this cool section one more time. Actually, let me start from the beginning. I'll play it all the way through until we get to this kind of vocal patch. And that's the last thing I'll explain today. So I say it all the time. I say you can take techniques from producers and artists. You don't have to necessarily be exactly like them. And this song is really taking techniques from a lot of different things, but it has my own stamp on it. And a lot of people are like, do you have any original songs, you know, without you sounding like somebody else? This is what I'm trying to show you how to do. We can take all those influences and make our own approach, but we're still using techniques and technologies from different artists. And technology means applied science. So here I have the Kanye effect, and I say Kanye because that's probably who you associate when you hear this. I just ran my vocals through an amplifier, a guitar amp simulator, and added a chords harmonizer for the vocals. So when I'm singing one note, the synthesizer or the plugin is generating other tones. So if I'm singing it, you know, it's going to go generate the other tones, like, you know, it's going to create those other tones based on the root note that I sing. So it's harmonizing automatically. So I have my harmonizer set to A minor. So at certain points it's a little flawed because I didn't map out the chords, etc., at that specific point. And I didn't automate it either, so it's just playing the same type of chord. But the harmonization it's creating is a minor chord. So right there it wasn't perfect, but it created texture for the moment. And you can see it was one long take. So I sliced out the sections that I didn't want. Let's hear the whole original, which is gonna sound like a mess because it was not scripted, it was kind of improv. So here's the real long version, just to hear how messy it got. And I cut out the parts that weren't musically good, that didn't match with the song. So you can see it was a long take, but I chopped it out because certain areas weren't musically fitting for this song. So this is why I'm saying you got to think rearranging. Everything doesn't have to be the way it is, the way it is. Meaning when you record something, you don't have to leave it as it is. You can change it up, chop it up, move it around, treat it like a sample. So that's the last section I have really to show you about this song. Now, when it's fully complete, I guess I'll go through the mix down and we can talk about that. But right now it's just raw. And I guess for people who skipped ahead, I'll play the song once more. And this song does excite me because it just hit a level that I wasn't expecting. And the reason I went through the breakdown is to show you the workflow of thought. How can you keep pushing these areas to the next level? And sometimes it becomes a creative puzzle to say, how can I push it to the next level? Sometimes you don't need to, but sometimes you do and you need to omit stuff. So for example, taking it to the next level could have been adding that Kanye type a vocal thing, but then taking it to the next level beyond that is to cut out parts that didn't match musically. So sometimes you have to keep pushing your track forward, but then cut out the extra fat around the edges. Okay, so it's just not obvious all the time until you keep pushing it to the next level. And that's what we're here to train you about right at BusyWorksBeats.com. We show you how to go through a song and keep pushing it to that next level so you can be a real producer rather than just, you know, a beat maker. And also, I want to note that some music production ideas came after I recorded the vocal. So everything wasn't just done musically first and then the vocal came. It was vocal stuff. It was music, vocal, and then music again. So that's how you revisit a song and really become a producer and put your hand in the actual shaping of the song. So I'll play it once more, and that'll be it. Now, this was not the full song either. So you have, what, three hooks. So this isn't a full song structure. I haven't written lyric for it either, but I just wanted to break it down for you because this one broke through many walls, and I think you can learn a lot from those techniques. So let's play it once more. So hopefully you took a lot out of this video, more than just listening to the song, but now listening back saying, oh, that's what that technique did. Oh, this is what decision was made at that point. That's why it sounds like this or that. So hopefully you have a new awareness about those elements now. Again, I'm going to break this down again when it comes to the full mix. It's not mixed or mastered yet. I'm trying to get it as loud as possible. I really haven't even checked the low end, which I probably should have beforehand, before I just put it up on YouTube, because it could be muffled. I'm not sure, but I'll check the low end next. So I thank you for joining me today here at BusyWorksBeats.com. If you want to learn more about music production, you can go right to BusyWorksBeats.com. We have free training for you. You can click that link below to get started now. Thanks for watching. It's BusyWorksBeats.com.